Random House Audio presents King Peggy by Peggielene Bartels and Eleanor Herman. Read for you by J. Karen Thomas. Prologue. In the dream, Peggy was back in Kumasi, a child again, walking home from school in her sky blue uniform with the round white collar. Usually, the path was dusty in the dry season, pocked with puddles in the rainy season, but now it was smooth as marble. Her black sandals glided over it, and her feet remained clean. The sky was a bright turquoise vault above her head, so beautiful it broke the heart, and the warm golden sun on her shoulders felt like a loving embrace. Just as she had every school day when she lived in Kumasi, in the dream she walked behind the king's palace, a rambling brick structure painted blue and white and built around a large courtyard where royal festivities were held. The Ashanti king of Kumasi, known as the Asantehene, was a very important leader with millions of subjects, and he was rich beyond measure because he owned some of the biggest gold mines in the world. All day at his palace, important visitors were coming and going, tribal priests, elders, government ministers, ambassadors, chairmen of important companies, and humble people asking him for justice. She stood outside the rear of the palace and looked at it, wondering what was going on in there. But there was nothing for her, a skinny little girl in a king's palace, and so she glided down the marble path to her home. Because Peggy had the dream so many times, she knew it must be a message from the spirit world. Like many Africans, Peggy understood that dreams meant something. They were not just random thoughts, fears, or hopes, or something from dinner irritating your intestines. Sometimes a dream was a message from God, or Jesus, or from your ancestors, or even from the better part of yourself talking to the stupid part of yourself. Dreams were like encoded letters from the spirit world that must be carefully decoded and interpreted. They guided you in your choices, warned you of deception and accidents, or showed you the future. "What does the dream mean, Mother?" Peggy asked when she called her mother in Ghana. Mother thought about it a long while. "It's been 30 years since you walked behind that palace to go to school in Kumasi," Mother said. "Perhaps it's just a memory. But why would I have it so often 30 years later?" Peggy insisted. "Here I am, living in the United States all this time. There's nothing to remind me of the king's palace in Kumasi. The dream has to mean something." A moment of silence dangled in the transatlantic air. Peggy could picture Mother's long, smooth face and shining dark eyes as she considered the question. Finally, she said, "Pray for God and the ancestors to show you what the dream means, Peggy. Perhaps in time, they will." Mother was right. God and the ancestors would show Peggy the meaning of the dream in their own time, but it would be long after Mother had joined them. Part 1. Washington, D.C., August through September 2008. Chapter 1. Is the king dead? Peggielene Bartels wondered as she stood in the small mailroom off the lobby, rubbing her thumbs across the front of the envelope. The ugly red stamp, undeliverable, splayed across the blue ink of the address, carefully penned in her own hand. For the third time, a letter to her Uncle Joseph had boomeranged back from Ghana. Another resident jostled her apologetically as he took out his little silver key and opened his mailbox, but Peggy just kept staring at the letter. Uncle Joseph was her mother's brother, and for 25 years he had been king of Otwam, a community of 7,000 souls where Peggy's family had originated hundreds of years earlier. Periodically, when she had returned to Ghana to visit her mother, the two of them would drive to Otwam to see Uncle Joseph, known there by his royal title, Nana Amua Afeni V. The king of Otwam was a tall man with heavy-lidded eyes, the lower lids revealing a great deal of white below the iris. He had been director of all the prisons in Accra, Ghana's capital. In 1983, at the age of 67, he had retired and, upon the unexpected death of his 63-year-old cousin, Nana Amua Afeni IV, was chosen the new king. Peggy remembered Uncle Joseph as a gentle, smiling man who never raised his voice, a man always ready to forgive, a man everybody liked. Sometimes Peggy wondered how such a man could be a king when kings were supposed to be tough and strong. If she had been in his position, she wasn't sure she would have been so kind. She wouldn't have cared if some people disliked her as long as she was a good king, punishing evildoers who took advantage of the weak. The last time she had seen Uncle Joseph was at her mother's funeral in 1997. He had arrived at her mother's home in Takoradi with a group of his elders, a kindness that even in her overwhelming grief, Peggy had appreciated. For years, she had regularly sent her mother money, and once her mother was in a better place where no money was needed, Peggy decided to send the money to her uncle out of respect. It was only $100 a month, but it went a long way in a Ghanaian town where many people lived on a dollar a day. And Peggy knew that even though Uncle Joseph was a king, he was not rich. His palace was falling down around his head, with a leaking roof and mildewed walls begging for spackling and fresh paint. And she worried that he might need medicine. He had been grateful for the money, and the two had kept in touch in the 11 years since her mother's passing. Earlier that year, had it been January, he had had a stroke and been hospitalized, but he had seemed to be recuperating. She had spoken to him on his cell phone now and then during his months-long stay in the hospital in Accra, and someone had picked up his mail for him at his post office box in Weneba, the city nearest to Otwam with mail service. But for the past 3 months, her letters had come bouncing back, nor had he collected her Western Union wire transfers. She had tried calling Uncle Joseph on his cell phone, but it was disconnected. How old would he be now? 90? No, 92. Truth be told, if he was dead, she probably wouldn't hear about it immediately. In Ghana, it was considered terribly disrespectful to say, "The king is dying," or "The king is dead." When the king was very ill in the hospital, people said, "The king has gone to his village for a cure." If it didn't look like the king was going to make it, his elder said, "The king is still in the village, taking care of himself." When they said, "He'll be in the village a long time, he won't be coming back anytime soon," that's when you knew he had died. But a king's elders didn't even say that right after the king died. They waited for weeks, even months after his death, before they said he wouldn't be coming back anytime soon from the village. The funny thing was that at a king's funeral, the embalmed body sitting stiffly on a royal chair, even then, nobody talked about him as dead. People said, "We hope the king is getting a good cure in the village, but we probably won't see him for a good while." How had this strange custom started? Peggy wondered. Maybe kingship raised kings above mere mortals, rendering it disrespectful to talk about them as dead or dying like the rest of humanity. Just as royalty wasn't supposed to be seen eating and drinking in public or running off to the toilet. Perhaps it was because kings, even after death, were thought to still rule over their kingdoms from the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.